Today we are going to derive lens maker's formula. Okay. Yeah, before going to derive this lens maker's formula, just we remember the condition for the refraction at spherical surface. So this we already derived this condition. Suppose light suffers a refraction on a curved surface like this. So light ray coming from an object O and suffers refraction at this point, and which forms an image at I in the second medium. Suppose N2 is the refractive index of second medium, N1 is first medium refractive index, and the distances from pole, the object and image are at U and V like this. Then the condition for this refraction is second medium refractive index by the distance or the image distance, that is V, minus first medium refractive index divided by the object distance N1 by U is equal to difference in their refractive indices, that is N2 minus N1 by radius of curvature of this surface. That means this. Okay. Now, based on this, we derive the lens maker's formula. Now, assume a lens like this, bounded by the radius of curvature of this surface is R1 and this surface is R2. Now, an object is at a distance at a point O, which is at a distance U. An image is formed at a point I, which is at a distance V from the pole of this second surface, and object distance is measured from the pole of this first curved surface. Assume that this is X, A, Y, and this is B. So, initially object is at a distance U from the pole of this first X, A, Y curved surface. Image is formed at a distance V from the pole of this X, B, Y surface. Now, assume that the second surface, absence of the second surface. That means, first consider the refraction at this first curved surface X, A, Y. Now, we can draw the diagram like this. Object O, which is at a distance U, and this is radius of curvature R1, and this is center of curvature for this C1. This is X, Y, A. Now the object is like this. Now, the normal to this surface is this. So, this is angle of incidence here. Now, as the light is refraction taking place at rarer to denser medium. So, this refracted ray bends towards the normal like this. Actually, this particular ray for this medium is appears to be coming at a point like this. So that means it forms a virtual image at this point. We take it as I dash, which is at a distance V dash. Okay. So the refraction at this surface, first curved surface X, A, Y, The object is at a distance u from the pole of this first curved surface, which the light ray is emitting in these two directions. One is along the principal axis, other is along this direction, which is incident at this surface with an angle of incidence I. So it bends towards the normal, which forms a virtual image at this point, which is at a distance v dash from this pole. Now the condition for this refraction is written as second medium refractive index, that is N2, by the image distance, that is v dash, minus first medium refractive index N1 by object distance u, equal to N2 minus N1 by R1. Okay. Now consider the second surface. Now this is x, b, y. This is center of curvature C2, and whose radius of curvature is R2. Now the angle of incidence is here. This one is the angle of incidence, the angle between the normal and the incident ray. Now for this second surface, this virtual object, which is virtual image formed by this first surface, acts as virtual object for this second surface, which gives image at another point I from B. Now this is V. This is angle of refraction. This is N2 and this is N1. Now for this refraction, the condition is N1 by image distance V minus N2 by object distance. That is, here we are to take the object distance from this point. Actually the object is from B to I, but originally we have taken from A. That's why we have to write this as V minus T, that equal to N1 minus N2 by R2. As the thickness of this lens is small, that means it is a thin lens, so this T can be neglected. So we can write it as just like V dash by T. Now we have two conditions. The first condition for the first surface, and this is the condition at the second surface. Now adding these two equations, that is N1 by V minus N2 by V dash minus N1 by U is equal to N2 by N1 by R1. And here N1 by V minus N2 by V dash is equal to N1 minus N2 by R2. Now the adding these two equations, this term will get cancelled. This implies we get a condition N1 by V minus N1 by U is equal to N2 minus N1 by R1 plus N1 minus N2 by R2. Okay. Now this is the condition we have obtained basing on these two conditions. Okay, now I rub this. From that equation we can write like this: N1 by V minus N1 by U is equal to N2 minus N1 by R1 minus half N2 minus N1 by R2. Now taking this N2 minus N1 common in this, 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. And here also N1 taking as common, 1 by V minus 1 by U. Now from this, 1 by V minus 1 by U is equal to N2 minus N1 by, like this, into 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. This is 1 by V minus 1 by U is equal to N21 minus 1 into 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. Now we have to consider an approximation that if the object is at an infinite distance, image is formed at the focus. In that case, we can take U as infinity and V as equal to focal length. That means if U tends to infinity, then V is equal to focal length F. So in that case we can write 1 by F minus 1 by infinity equal to N21 minus 1 into 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. So this implies 1 by F is equal to N2 minus 1 into 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. So this is Lenz-Meyer's formula. This is like this. So 1 by F is equal to N21 minus 1, 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. Now this is valid for both convex lens and concave lens. Now for a convex lens we can consider like this. We know the convex lens is like this. That means this is first surface and this is second surface. Now if R1 is radius of curvature and R2 is radius of curvature of the second one, then this is R1 and this is R2. Okay. Now as light is incident in this direction, so according to sign convention, all the distances are measured from the pole and the distances measured in the direction of light are taken as positive, which are opposite with the distances measured opposite to the direction of light are taken as negative. Now for a convex lens like this, so R1 is in the direction of light, so R1 is positive, whereas R2 is opposite to the direction of light, so R2 is negative. So for convex lens, R1 is positive, R2 is negative. So if R1 is positive means it is like light only, R2 is negative means this negative term, so we will get a positive term here, so that F becomes positive. For the case of concave lens like this, this is R1 and this is R2, then this distance is R1, this distance is R2. Now light is in this direction. Now for this case, R1 is, this R1 is opposite to the direction of light, that is this R1 is negative, and R2 is in the direction of propagation of light, so R2 is positive. So for concave lens, R1 is negative, R2 is positive. If R1 is negative means this term is negative one, R2 is positive means already there is a negative term, so this term is also a negative term. So finally F is a negative term. So for a convex lens, focal length is positive. For a concave lens, focal length is negative. Okay. Now from that relation, actually we have derived like this, 1 by V minus 1 by U is equal to N21 minus 1 into 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2, and that is equal to 1 by F by that relation. So we can write the Lenz equation as 1 by V minus 1 by U is also equal to 1 by F. Okay. Now, power of a lens. As we know that when a parallel beam of light is incident on a convex lens, all these rays converge after refraction through the lens. Suppose if you consider two lenses like this, another lens. That means the converging property is different in these two cases. So it is defined as the power of the lens. Now we consider a light ray incident on the lens like this. Then, after refraction, it passes through the focus F. Now, the angle of convergence is this one. Now, this delta is considered as angle of convergence in the case of convex lens. Now, suppose if we assume that this incident ray is at a distance h from the optic center O. Now it is converged to focus, means this distance is equal to focal length F. Now the power of the lens is defined as the tangent of the angle of converge by the lens when a light ray is incident at a unit distance from its optic center. That means the tangent of the angle of by which the lens converges or diverges a light ray incident at a distance, unit distance from the optic center, is called its lens. That means the tangent of the angle, now this is the angle of convergence, so this angle is also equal to here. From this triangle, tan delta is equal to h by f. So usually for paraxial rays, this delta is small. For small angles, tan delta equal to delta, so this is equal to h by f. So power of the lens is simply equal to the angle of convergence for paraxial rays. Now from this, actually by definition, this distance is considered as unit distance. That means if h equal to 1 unit, then tan delta or p is equal to 1 by f. So power of the lens is numerically equal to the reciprocal of its focal length. Okay. So power of a lens means its ability to converge the light rays which are incident on the lens is called its power. So which is measured as the tangent of the angle of convergence or divergence by a lens when that light ray is incident at unit distance from the optic center. So numerically, it is equal to the reciprocal of focal length. And this, the unit of this power is diopter, denoted by the letter D, or meter inverse. Okay. And this power is positive for a convex lens and a negative for a concave lens. Okay. Now, location of image by graphical method. So to locate the image formed by a convex lens or a concave lens by graphical method, we have to consider three light rays out of these three light rays, we can consider any two light rays. So those rays are, first one, a light ray passing through this optic center will not suffer any deviation. So it is like this. And second ray is, a light ray parallel to the principal axis will pass through the focus after refraction through the lens, like this. And another ray, if the light ray passes through focus, first focus, in this direction, it becomes parallel to the principal axis after refraction through the lens. So out of these three rays, we can consider any two rays to locate the position of the image by graphical method. Similarly, the same three rays are considered in the case of concave lens also. Okay. Now, the equivalent focal length of two lenses in contact. Now, lenses combination. Now, consider two convex lenses which are kept in contact like this, so that the principal axis of both these lenses coincide, or we can arrange them as coaxially, like this. Now, object is placed at a distance u from this first lens, and an image is formed at I and the second edge at V. Now, like this. Now, the equivalent focal length of this combination of this lens, equivalent focal length means, suppose if we replace these two lens by a single lens, then the focal length of that single lens is the equivalent focal length of these two. Okay. Now, consider the object and image is formed by this. Now, first considering the only first lens, that means for this first lens, it forms a virtual image of this object at a point I dash. So this object O is the object for this first lens, which forms its image at I dash, and this I dash acts as virtual object for the second lens, and which forms an image at I. Okay. Now, the condition for this first lens is, suppose assume that this is F1 and this is F2. Now, for the first lens, we can write it as 1 by F1 is equal to, its object distance is u, that is 1 by u minus, and its image distance is v, that is, v dash, like this. So, 1 by v dash minus 1 by u. Now, for the second lens, we can write 1 by f2 is equal to, and its object distance is v dash, and image distance is v. So, you can write it as 1 by v minus 1 by v dash. As this, consider that these two lenses are thin lens, so that the distances, these thicknesses of these lenses are neglected. So, from these two equations, adding these two equations, we get 1 by f1 plus 1 by f2 is equal to 1 by v dash minus 1 by u plus 1 by v minus 1 by v dash. Now these terms gets cancelled. That is 1 by v minus 1 by u. That is 1 by f1 plus 1 by f2 equal. But this v and u are the image distance of object distance of this combined lens. So, that can be written as 1 by f, where this f is the equivalent focal length of this combination of this lens. So, 1 by f is equal to 1 by f1 plus 1 by f2. And this is the relation of lenses in combination, we can extend this to any number of lenses. Suppose if we have n number of lenses, then we can write it as 1 by f is equal to 1 by f1 plus 1 by f2, etc., plus 1 by fn. Now, if another condition is, if these two lenses are separated by a small distance d, the first lens of focal length f1, second lens of focal length f2, separated by a small distance d. In this case, the equivalent focal length is 1 by f is equal to 1 by f1 plus 1 by f2 minus d by f1 f2. I am not going to derive this equation, you just note this point. Okay? So, if two lenses are separated by a distance, a finite distance d, then the equivalent focal length is this one. Suppose if these two are in contact, means this d becomes 0. If we substitute d 0 here, this term is 0, then again this equation goes to this equation. Okay? Now, the next topic is refraction through prism. So, what is a prism means? Prism is a transparent medium bounded by three plane surfaces like this. And these three plane surfaces intersect in three parallel lines. So, suppose this is A, B, C, E, F, D. So, this B, C, D, F is one surface, and B, A, E, F is one surface, and CA, ED is another surface. These three surfaces intersect on three parallel lines CD, AE and BF. Now, one of the face is grounded like this. Suppose this is grounded and other two are made bright. And these two bright surfaces are called refracting surfaces, and this, the line of these two refracting surfaces intersect, that is AE, is called refracting edge of this prism, and the angle between these two bright surfaces or refracting surfaces is called refracting angle of the prism, or simply it is called angle of the prism. Now, if we consider a plane perpendicular to all these three surfaces is called principal axis of this prism, and which is usually these prism principal axis, principal section of these prisms are usually triangle. If all the angles are equal, equilateral triangles are right angle, or it may be small angle prisms. Now how this refraction takes place in prism? Now consider this ABC as the principal section, where A is the refracting angle of this prism. Now, light ray is incident at a point on the surface AB. So, right ray, now we write it, draw normal. This is the angle of incidence here. Say it as I1. Now, it is refracted and again incident at this point. Now, draw a normal here also. And this is R1, and this is R2. Now here the emergent ray is like this, and this is angle of emergence I2. Now first, why we are drawing this incident ray is bending towards the base of the prism, because this is a rarer medium and glass is a denser medium, and again it is a rarer medium. So this particular ray is incident or traveling from rarer to denser medium. So this refracted ray bends towards the normal. Now here the light ray is traveling from denser to rarer medium. Here the refracted ray moves away from the normal. That's why the incident ray is always bends towards the base of the prism. Now, in absence of the prism, this light ray travels in this direction actually, but it is deviated through this direction. So this angle is called angle of deviation d, or small d, take it as small d. Now point out this A, B, C, so take it as D, and this is E, and this is F. Okay, so light ray is incident at an angle I1 on this surface and emerges through an angle I2 from this surface. Now consider this A, D, F, E quadrilateral. The total angle of this quadrilateral is 360 degree, so we can write it as A plus this angle D. Angle at this angle AD, angle A, so angle at D. So this angle is 90 degree. That means here the quadrilateral sides are AD and DF, where the angle is 90 degree, because this is the normal to this surface. So we can write it as A plus 90 plus here the angle is F plus here the angle again it is 90 degree, because the surface AE and EF are perpendicular. So here the angle is 90, this equal to 360. So we can write it as A plus F is equal to 180. So F is equal to 180 minus A. Now the triangle, from the triangle DEF, DEF, in this term DE the angle is R1, here the angle is R2, here the angle is F. So from this triangle we can write R1 plus R2 plus F is equal to 180. Means F is equal to 180 minus half R1 plus R2. That equal to, you take it as equation 2, we can consider equation 1. Now from 1 and 2 we can write that, see here it is 180 minus A, here it is 180 minus R1 plus R2. So R1 plus R2 is equal to A. Now PQREFG, now consider the triangle DEG. In this triangle, if this is R1 and the angle between these two sides is 90, so this one is I1 minus R1 and here it is I2 minus R2. So this is the angle of incidence, so this total angle is I1. So the, as this is R1, so this is I1 minus R1. Here also this total angle is R2, that means this ray and this angle is R2. So this is R2, so this is I2 minus R2. Now from the triangle DEG we can write, now in this triangle these I1 minus R1 and I2 minus R2 are interior angles and this D is exterior angle. So for this triangle, I1 minus R1 and I2 minus R2 are interior angles and D is exterior angle. So we can write the sum of these two interior angles is equal to this exterior angle. So we can write it as I1 minus R1 plus I2 minus R2 is equal to D. So I1 plus I2 minus of R1 plus R2 is equal to D. So from these two equations, I1 plus I2 is equal to D plus of R1 plus R2. But R1 plus R2 is equal to A. So this equal to A plus D. So I1 plus I2 is equal to A plus D. No another condition. Okay? So here first the light ray is incident at D with an angle of incidence I1. As this is moving, as traveling from rarer to denser medium, the refracted ray bends towards the normal like this, and it is which is again incident on this surface AC at E, and the emergent ray emerges through an angle I2. As this ray is traveling from denser to rarer medium, this refracted ray moves away from the normal, so this is like this. Now, we have first considered a quadrilateral ADFE. From that quadrilateral, sum of the angles is 360. So this A, here it is D is 90 degree, and the angle at E is 90 degree, and the angle is F. So A plus 90 plus F 90 equal to 360. So A plus F equal to 180. From that, F is equal to 180 minus A. Now, from this triangle DFE, R1 is one angle, R2 is another angle, and the third angle is angle F. So sum of these three angles is 180. So we can write it as F equal to 180 minus R2. So comparing this 1 and 2, we can write R1 plus R2 is equal to A. Now considering the triangle DEG, in this triangle, I1 minus R1 and I2 minus R2 are interior angles, and this D is exterior angle. So sum of these two interior angles is equal to the exterior angle D. So we can write this equation as I1 plus I2 equal to A plus D. Okay. Now, it is experimentally verified that if the angle of incidence It is experimentally observed that if we draw a graph between angle of incidence and angle of deviation, the angle of deviation decreases with the increase in angle of incidence, and it reaches to a minimum value and again increases like this. So if we draw a graph between the angle of incidence I on x-axis, angle of deviation D on y-axis, we get a curve like this. That means with the increase in angle of incidence, the angle of deviation decreases and decreases to a minimum value, and then the angle of deviation increases. Okay. Now, if we draw a line parallel to this angle of incidence x-axis like this, or perpendicular to this deviation axis, this line intersects this curve at two different points. Here it is and here. So, if we draw a line perpendicular to this deviation axis, it intersects at two different points. So, this one is I1 and this side at two different points. That means for two angles of incidence, we get the same deviation value. That means if we interchange I2 and I1, we get the same deviation value. Now, if we draw another line here, like this, we get another set of two values, I1 dash and I2 dash. As we draw this curve from this one, that means the angle of deviation decreases to another point where this I1 and I2 becomes closure. Now, if we draw a line at this point corresponding to minimum deviation, this I1 and I2 coincide at this point. That means under the minimum deviation condition, this I1 is equal to I2. So in this condition, Actually, our line is like this, I1, I2. This is I2 and this is I1, R1 and R2. So, under minimum deviation condition, this I1 and I2 coincide. That means at that particular condition, I1 is equal to I2. That means if I1 is equal to I2 means this R1 and R2 also becomes equal. So, under minimum deviation condition, I1 is equal to I2 and R1 is equal to R2. So, assume that I1 equal to I2 is taken I and R1 and R2 are equal to R. So, from our conditions, we can write that as we have a condition R1 plus R2 is equal to A, means R1 plus R2 we consider as R. So, 2R is equal to A and R is equal to A by 2. And from this condition, as I1 and I2 are equal and that is considered as that equal to I, so we can write this equation as 2I is equal to A plus, here the deviation is minimum deviation, we replace it by DM. Okay, so I is equal to A plus DM by 2. Now, the refractive index of the material of the prism is given by N is equal to sin I by sin R. Actually, it is refractive index of material of the prism with respect to the medium. We can consider always as A. So, you can directly write refractive index of the material of the prism. So, from these conditions R and I, this N equal to sin of I is A plus DM by 2 by sin R is A by 2. So, sin A by 2. So, this is the, by this equation we can determine the refractive index of material of the prism by experimental. Now, for the case of small angled or thin prisms, these angles are very small. So, for small angles we can consider the sin theta is equal to theta. So, in that case we can write it as sin A plus DM by 2 is equal to A plus DM by 2 and sin R by 2 is equal to, sin A by 2 is equal to A by 2. So, in that case the refractive index N is equal to A plus DM by 2 by A by 2, or can write as A plus DM by A, that is 1 plus DM by A. So, we can write as DM by A is equal to N minus 1, or the deviation we can write as A into N minus 1. And this is valid only for small angle or thin prisms. For otherwise, we have to use this relation. So, if we draw a graph between these two, we get the curve like this. This means the angle of deviation decreases and decreases to a minimum value and then increases. Now, if we draw a line perpendicular to this deviation axis, it will intersect our this curve at two different points corresponding to the angle of incidences I1 and I2. Now, if we draw another line like this, this we get I1 dash and I2 dash, which that means I1 and I2 are become closure. If we draw a line at the minimum deviation position, these I1 and I2 becomes equal. Okay.